I want to start today with Arnold Toynbee because he was my inspiration in Oxford. From 1934 to 1961, he wrote something quite extraordinary, 12 volumes, A Study of History, in which he took it upon himself to compare, as it were, the works of history. The works. What civilizations do we have? How do they differ? And he came up with a gratifying, memorable conclusion, which I commend to your attention, and therefore I printed it in red. Cultures are responses to challenges. And I tell you, for example, to him, Chinese civilization basically a response to the challenge of the goddamn floods. The Nile, you see, why do you have this big fuss of civilization in around the Nile? The floods of the Nile needed to be controlled. There was a challenge. Culture is a response and not a terrific activity, because you were very good at something. You see what I mean? So it's not because you suddenly feel very creative that you start a culture, but it is because you are challenged to it, you see? And so you have the Nilotic culture, and by the way, to just pursue this one line of floods and water control, you see, the Sumerian and so on, ancient cultures of Mesopotamia, would fall into this kind of pattern very generally, and then one can say this is probably not true, but he had this idea that culture generally is a response to challenge, and I think that linguistic culture is not an exception. And so now I would say that a culture consists in a restricted repertoire of culturally available grammatical choices for you, of behavior, in phonology, certain sounds you do make, other sounds you don't make. And can you see what I mean? There is an infinitude of sounds you might utter. They're quite remarkable. If you go to Africa, they can teach you a lesson or two about the sounds that one can make in language. And we don't, right? And what I believe a culture is very much as in phonology. It restricts a fairly well-defined repertoire of restricted, available, and acceptable grammatical choices. And Fernand Braudel, Grammaire des Civilisations, he wrote a book that made this explicit. He thought that civilizations, are defined by something that one is tempted to call the grammar of the acceptable. Can you see that? And you will see in what remains of this class that we are going to look at the repertoire, for example, of the functions that grammatically correctly expressions can fulfill or can have in classical Chinese, right? That's a complete repertoire. You could do all sorts of things, I tell you. But we will define the 1,225 such functions that you can look up in Thesaurus Linguae Sericae, TLS. And we will, of course, only look at a choice of these and leave it to you to explore the rest, as it were, online, right? That's one repertoire. But you have another repertoire. For example, the words for to laugh in ancient Chinese, I think we were into this, are four, three of which are never used. So it's basically when any laughing behavior in ancient Chinese is going to be xiao, as sure as hell. And that's in contrast to the Ming Dynasty situation with about 500 such words for to love, and today 794 that old Christoph has taken the trouble to collect, lexicalized words for to love, 794. So you can see this repertoire is not stable, the culture evolves, right? So the laughing sensibilities of the ancient Chinese have, you can say, developed and have been elaborated in an extraordinary way, which we will see towards the end of this course. So then, using a language is, mark my words, using a language is making a choice from a pre-existing repertoire. And here we are, we need, in order to define that choice, we need to establish what the repertoire is. That's what our business is here now. To establish what it is that you choose from when you speak Chinese, right? In terms of grammatical functions, and as we will see, in terms of a lot of other things that I won't go into now. But you have this, and now I have been challenged to Xia Yu, and I chickened out because I'm too interested in this, and I know that one is always worse at the things that one is most interested in, and I thought that I would spend too much time on it if I didn't chicken out last time. But now I chicken in, and I will tell you all you need to know about Xia Yu down rain, right? How do I take it? I take it to mean send down rain, and I take it to mean it downs rain. It is a VT, subjectless, nobody downs it, you see? But it is rain, and rain is NM. You have it? So what we now have, I hope you sympathize with me, right? Xia Yu is not an expression which invites us to think of who xia's it. And also, it is an expression which does take the yu as the object of xia. And so, xia here is a derived meaning to send down, to it falls, right? It manifests fallingly, is how I take it, right? It manifests fallingly here. We have here a falling case of. You have it, huh? So, compare. Now that's fascinating, right? Because in Chinese you have yu, which is the shang sheng. In fact, correct pronunciation of shang sheng is shang sheng. But I will not go into this in detail. I swear to you, it is a mispronunciation, a vulgar mispronunciation to pronounce the shang sheng, shang sheng.
But shang is, if you read it as shang, it becomes qi sheng, it's not a shang sheng anymore.
It's unfortunate, yes, I know. But in modern Chinese, this has turned into a shang sheng, into a falling tone, as sure as hell, and there is no evidence to the contrary, except that some pedants like to remind themselves that the shang sheng, of course, is best given by saying shang. Right, and of course, in Middle Chinese, it was shang. Enough. Can you see? Shue has a suffix which we all, for some reason, believe Professor Audricourt of Paris has solved the problem for us. It had a final S. I wasn't there. It certainly is a falling tone, right, which is very generally today reconstructed as a final S by common consent. Such common consent, as Professor Plato has pointed out a long time ago, can be a common consent on a mistake. But I'm not saying it is, I'm just saying it might very well be. The consent as such proves nothing. So, can you see now, I say unto you that Yisha is a very nice example of a subjectless VT construction, right? And we have Yu Huang, you know, it can Yu locusts, and it can Yu all sorts of other things. None of these things that are being Yu'd are actually being Yu'd by anyone. Yes, but we don't say Tian Yu Huang, it's always Yu Huang. Yeah, Tian Yu Xue, can you say, as we now go, you see, you always anticipate, you see, you are. What do we say when I put up one thing, you already have a response to the three things. We will get to them now. You also have Yao Zhi. And now you can see, we gratis, you get the latest view on the concept of existence in Chinese, which I actually take to be very much along these lines. So let's have a look. Existence. French, il y a, qui a, a chez yo, a chez yo. So the French is as misleading as English. It exists. It exists a man, you see, a Frenchman might want to say that, but it's not very good. Il y a in French then has what we could kind of hoping that nobody asks any stupid questions, say called a dummy subject and so on. It's all not very good because the point is it ain't a subject. See, it's a very, very strange thing we have there. And so, Yoren, how do you read this? Yoren. He said, Yoren, what does that mean? No, there is a person in there, you know. Not a Yoren. Yoren.
No, like knock on the door. Yomiren.
Yeah, Yomiren. Right. Are there people in there?
Yeah.
Yoren. And now that is Yoren. And it means it manifests a person. It manifests a person, of course, I'm not suggesting to you. I mean, my English may be poor, but it's not so poor that I don't know that you can't say it manifests a person. But I'm trying to suggest to you that this is how it hangeth together in Chinese, right? That the thing after yo is an object indeed, and that we have yoren as it manifests a person, there is a person which works exactly as yushue. You have it? So here you have a pocket version of Habsmeyer's new theory on existence in Chinese published a year ago in a festschrift for the finest specialist in historical grammar, Alain Perrobe of Paris. I think he's our great master in the field. You can disagree, and I'm sure he does, but it is unfortunately printed in his festschrift, so he has to live with it. So then I would like to point out that you also have Yoren. What does that mean? What does that mean, Peter? Yoren.
Sorry?
Yeah?
Oh, I don't know.
There is indeed people.
No.
Some people.
Yes, some people, you see? So, you can even have, if you're careful, if you're not careful, you can have a. In any case, Yoren is some guy. Yoren. Yoren, sure, Yoren. And there is no N there, actually, when you listen carefully. Yoren, sure, Yoren. It's very slight nasalization of this final N, if you ask me. Anyway, Yoren has an N and is heavy, and Yoren does not have an N and is light. No, you know, you can have, but it's much lighter. And if you look at the recordings, you find it's very often absent. So we have Yoren and have person, and then you have someone. And that is, of course, the same as Yo Di Ren. And in good old days, we would teach our students, you know, Yo Di Ren, Hui Zhi Yang, for Yo Di Ren, Bu Xing, and so on. But that is, of course, very German. Yo Ren is. So you can see, as I have tried to adumbrate before, we would want to say that stress is crucial, even in these contexts. Yes.
So I wonder if you could maybe clarify why the construction "yōren" is unique to expressing existence in Chinese, because if I were to analyze that from a perspective, like a cross-linguistics perspective,
yeah.
we have "es gibt" in German,
yeah.
and then we could just simply say that "es gibt." German has a parameter that says, okay, we can have dummy subjects, but Chinese classical, modern, or otherwise
has zero dummy subjects. You can
well,
order.
It just doesn't have the parameter that inserts.
So yeah, I think let us not, as I say, you know, I am really afraid that we might waste this hour. We have all the nouns to go through. Let's leave it.
Right, and so I'm not saying, so you know, substantiate or classify that theory. I'm just wondering why this is so unique to the Chinese concept.
Oh, I'm not saying it's unique. I'm just saying that's how it works in Chinese. You see.
Okay.
And that you basically have a yu xue, which tells you how your ren functions. That's all. You know. And we should, I think, let's press on. You know. So yeah,
I understand perfectly how the first case of your ren works, but the second case it seems like it has some property of a sentence, but it's actually a modifier.
Yes. So as I say, your ren is. Has a yo, which is actually V at N.
But sometimes you ask yo ren shi gan ma. What is this? Is yo a predicate or something?
Then you have ambiguity. Let's press on. You can have ambiguity. You can. So when we say yu alone, we are saying it is raining. That's just a VI zero, right? No problem. Our big problem was the xia yu, and not this one, right? This is just a VI zero. And so if you're interested in personal construction across linguistic perspective, that is where your questions will be not only raised but discussed on 400 pages. And of course, we could spend the rest of our class now discussing this. I don't think we should. This is a good book. Malchukov and Anna Siewierska, Impersonal Constructions, Amsterdam. And Frédéric Lambert, Peut-on parler de l'impersonnel en grec ancien? Very fine study of the problem in Greek. Very nice. And it is part of a larger work, L'impersonnel, la personne, le verbe, la voix. A very fine book of which this is a part. I give you this book actually partly because I want to remind you that French does exist, as it were, you know, as a language in which quite interesting research on these matters is published. And this is one monograph, you know, on the impersonal constructions in here. And so we then have Tian Yu, and I would just remind you that for me that is VI. Zero, causative. So it is heaven causes it to rain. So U there is VI zero, but it's used causatively. Cause it to rain, right? Can you see what I mean? So that is how I get around the Tian Yu, and I find that different from a subject predicate construction in which heaven, as it were, is the agent.
Are you talking about modern Chinese?
This is classical Chinese.
My teacher taught me this should be pronounced Tian Yu instead of
Tian. But that, you know, where we can look this up and test it, we can test this up in Jing Dian Shi Wen, you see? And there you can see that, in fact, I remember that. There are cases where Tian Yu comes and where he has it as third talk. But that's a kind of very good question. We can do it. Yeah. What I do know is that in Jingdian Shiwen of 647 AD, if I'm not mistaken, something like that, in that book, Yu Xue is definitely fought on. Good. So the other thing, the other challenge that I want to respond to, since we have a linguistic culture here, is that we were told that you can't have ike shumu, and you can't count shumu. So this is an interesting question. I muttered to you. It is a very interesting question. And so we have shao shi yong yi ci xing kuai zi, ren zhou duo yi ke shu mu, is in fact it can be viewed written, you see, as a slogan, right? So here you, I don't want to go into detail, but it says, you know, you can then save one more tree of any kind. And the point then is that Shu Mu here is not a particular tree but of any kind. You know? It's a kind of very generalizing way in which you count it. So you have also, you see, Yi Tian Ke Shu Mu, Hui Chu, Yi Tian Ke Shu Mu, of all kinds. And you also have Lang Fei Ji Ke Shu Mu. And you have lots of more examples that I give you here, and then I put it up for you, and you can believe me that it was not useless to make this objection, because all these have something in common, namely a kind of ecological context, you know, shumo of any kind. So you've really taught me a lesson, and I'm very glad we took this up. You know, we took this up. It's an interesting thing. It's untrue that we cannot count these. But when we do, it has this curious effect.
I doubt if this has to do with the number. I think 100棵树木 might be acceptable, but 101棵树木 is never acceptable.
Exactly, exactly. That's this kind of thing, yes. So we have this.
Why would we not be able to count trees?
What?
Why would we not be able to count trees?
Well, you cannot count shumu, you see. Last hour, you know, I was very interested in that remark, you know. You don't say san ke, you know, and so on. And therefore, we always have yi ke, yi qian ke, you see, yi bai ke, and that kind of thing. I think you have a very good point there. So I think we men zhang le yi ge zhi, fan le yi ge zuo, zhang le yi ge zhi. We have grown in wisdom. This is quite a subtle issue. It's a subtle issue. It's not so simple. It's not simple uncountability. Enough. So now, you see, we have B is a maid, and we have Qie is a concubine, and we have B Qie, you see, which is collective and can't be counted. Sanga B Qie B Qie. So that is why I believed you immediately when you said it, because it reminded me of this situation. You cannot count Sanga B Qie in Chinese, absolutely not. Not in my dialect of ancient Chinese. So next one, you have been, you know, an honored guest, and you have ke, any foreigner guest, stranger, and now you can predict bin ke, you know, sanga bin ke, no. See, interesting. You don't say san bin ke, you see? San ke. Yeah. We can look for examples, but basically, this is collective, right, and plural, and bin ke is, for example, never, like pengyou. Simply, so you would, I believe, agree with me that bing ke does not work like modern Chinese peng you. Bing ke is more collective. And you can probably find some countings of bing ke, but it's not, does not invite it. So it is close to this phenomenon that we had with shu, you know, bin ke. Tooth, for example, you have chi, and you have ya, ya, and you have chi ya. See, and chi ya is plural, and never yi ge chi ya, liang ge chi ya. Is it interesting? Yeah. And so, basically, the story that we all, that I have told for decades to my students, that Chinese binomes arise from the fact that one way of expressing the thing is not as clear as the addition of another synonym would make it, and that you therefore had these binomes developing in classical Chinese, which then turned into modern Chinese obligatory.
Yeah, wasn't it motivated by sound change?
Yeah, which has not with sound changed. No, there's no big deal about sound change here. It is simply that the synonym compounds in ancient Chinese function deeply differently from the modern Chinese synonym compounds, and that I didn't know until I studied the matter. So I give you another example. A pigeon, you can now predict. You know, this is not going to mean, you know, you can count a pigeon, you know, and so on. So for example, yi and fu, and you cannot try yi fu in ancient Chinese. You see? You can only yi fu, you see? Yi, to wear fu, a clothes, but you cannot. Chuan Yi Fu. Chuan Yi Fu, no. So Yi Fu, generic, you see, and perhaps sometimes counted. I have not seen it, but you have me scared. Maybe you can find one, you know. I don't know, I wasn't there. So you have, for example, Yi Shan, also. Yi Shan, also, garments, you see. None of these function like in classical Chinese as they do in modern. And that is what I have, for decades, failed to understand, and have told people this lie, that the ancient Chinese binomes, you see, are what we see in modern Chinese. So buildings, you have gong, gong shi, would not be one building, you see, and you have dian, lu, and so on and so on, and you get here gong shi, buildings, gong dian, palaces, lu shi, cottages, shi wu, homes, dian wu, and so on and so on and so on. So I think you will be pleased to know that the system that I'm presenting to you is instantiated, you know, by many dozens of such binomes that all have this in common, that synonyms are put together. And when they are put together, they create actually a generic collective noun, and they have a semantic effect which they don't have in modern Chinese. Gong dian is just one bloody palace. Oh, one palace. and so on. You have it? So it's concrete reference. And so we have these NP with the semantic feature plural. And we have laws and regulations, so you have fa and lu, and you don't have ego fa lu in classical Chinese. Can you see? We have discovered something that would cause you to have to rewrite a lot of translations into English, you see, which pretend that fa lu in classical Chinese is like fa lu in modern Chinese, which it is not. So we have that, and you have, of course, ling lu, fa hao, and so on. All these are, yes?
Sorry, what were we saying that fa lu means in ancient Chinese?
In ancient Chinese means the fa and the lu generally. It cannot refer to one fa lu.
Oh, I understand.
So then you have, for example, chuhuan. You all know this. Hay grain, right? By metonymy, grass and grain fed animals, right? And you can see the flesh of them. So you have a double metonymy, which is very nice. Can you get it? A double metonymy. First, these animals who are fed with it, and then another metonymy, the flesh of these. And all this inspired, actually, by your wonderful remarks. Dao Lu, you see? Dao Lu, you see? In classical Chinese, I think you now have the hang of it, you see? You simply learned 一课这个古代汉语的语法, Dao Lu is not an extended way of saying Dao or Lu. You cannot say 这条道路, oh. You have it? Mm. So, we learned a thing or two about these homo-synonym compounds. And we have, for example, sinfo. What is that? 闻诸道路不知信佛. How do you translate that?
I don't know if it's true. Or somebody
has it wrong. Yeah. You see, I have heard it, and then not in this street or that, but you see, in the streets. You see, I have generic reference, right? And I don't know whether it is true or not. I give you this sentence because my very dear colleague Chad Hansen became very famous for denying that the Chinese have a concept of truth. I think you should be afraid of these kinds of sentences. but of course he's a very good friend, and he's quite right that he has very usefully challenged us to show that Chinese does have this abstract concept of truth, which we see here, sinfo, is an abstract way of saying the truth or falsehood, right? So it's an abstract reference to truth. I don't know about the truth or otherwise. So it's quite abstract.
Yes? I have a comment on the isyllabic adjectives or so-called adjectives in modern Chinese.
Yeah.
I just thought of it in a moment, but actually, bisyllabic adjectives in modern Chinese is able to express a degree. The degree information is encoded in bisyllabic adjectives, but not in monosyllabic adjectives. I think that might be similar to the nouns.
Yeah, that could be investigated, you know, when that is the case. But my very dear friend Feng Shengli has pointed out that the use of monosyllabic versus bisyllabic adjectives is very often determined by the monosyllabic or bisyllabic main noun, you see, the rhythmic rules. So it's a very interesting phenomenon, and therefore, since that is the case, you see, you can't always expect a semantic difference. Let's leave it aside. You have here now, jian. 然佛之分, can you see that? To see the distinction between truth and not, truth and falsehood. You can also 通古今变然佛, right? So you have 信佛 and 然佛, both used to refer to the abstract notion of truth. And on that note, we end the first part of this class. We take a little pause, and then we will 大大 进入 our nominalization and noun bestiary. Thank you. Which is not so much occasioned by challenges, but a presentation of a system, namely that of grammatical taxonomies. Do we know who this is? Linné, right. And he was very keen on empirical research, and this is what he looked like in more detail. And he is from Uppsala, and I, in fact, used to breakfast in the place where he had held his lion, because he did have a lion. And famous he became for getting the point that understanding nature amounts to understanding a theoretically transparent and comprehensive systematic conceptual taxonomy, right? That's what he became famous, desperately famous for. He was, in a way, the first person to have comprehended nature as a taxonomic system. And he brought this out as Systema Naturae, a system of nature. First edition, 1735, 11 pages. 10th edition, a little larger, two fat volumes, 4,400 species and 7,000 plants. I'm reminding you of this, that for him to understand nature was to reduce it to a taxonomically explicit system. And I think it's entirely relevant and very nice that so close to his statue, we can now look at grammar and the lexicon as a taxonomic system, right? Understanding something in nature is to understand its place in a well-defined taxonomic system, and one must study conceptual schemes and not individual concepts. That is what we are going to do, right? And that is what, for example, you have in taxonomic lexical entries. For example, the Great Dictionary of the Chinese Language, Hanyu Da Cidian, right? It ranks as the greatest of the Chinese dictionaries, the 12 fat volumes. And the word fa, for that word, it lists 81 meanings, meaning 1 to meaning 81, right? And this represents impressive Xungu philology. And in the scientific spirit of Linnaeus, one would like to create a structural taxonomy of meanings, and certainly not say meaning 1 to 81, exactly as, I believe, Linnaeus would laugh at you if you listed the animals as animal 1 down to animal 7,722. You get it? So basically what I'm saying is, don't look down at the 17th century. Learn from Linnaeus that to grasp something like the meanings of a word is to grasp the taxonomy of the meanings attributed to it, and not just listing them 1 to 62, or 81 in this case. And there is no dictionary of traditional Chinese dictionary that gives you this taxonomy, and we need it. In modern times, you do have the Yuanliu Cidian, which tried to give this, but they're all very small. So there we go. We want to start with some basic meanings and then deriving the other meanings along well-defined paths of derivation from the basic ones. You get it? That's what we need to do. And so we now do a taxonomic system of grammatical functions. Exactly the same thing. We say we shall now outline a taxonomic system of all the functions that any expression or constituent can have in classical Chinese. That's incredibly ambitious. We say, you know, all things that a word can do in a sentence, you see, will fall under one of the categories that we specify. That's very ambitious. And no book that you can mention to me does anything remotely of the kind. Thus, I am not about to give you a list of word classes from 1 to 1,212. You see? On the contrary, I will define a conceptual scheme. And look now at the Systema Mundi Tychonicum. Do you know him? Tycho Brahe, who is said to have died because he could not manage to go to the toilet when he was with the king. Tycho Brahe, this is what he looks like.
He had a false nose.
Is he also? Yes, it's all very exciting. And he lived very close to where we live in Copenhagen, I dare say, very close. And also, he had a taxonomy. But that was a taxonomy which was spatial, the universe, right? Because he placed things in space. And I want to put this in to show to you that's not what we are going to do. We are going to place things not in space and specifying where and so on and so on, but we want to create a conceptual space. And that conceptual space consists of a genus, a species, a subspecies, a sub-subspecies, and a sub-sub-subspecies on a taxonomic tree. You have it? That's very important. So you will remember now. We have our nominals, and we have our verbals, and we have our particles, and that is, as it were, the top layer of our taxonomy, right? There are those three. And all other things are down the tree, hanging below these three. You have it? And then what we want to say is that these nouns themselves have certain semantic attributes that are not grammatical functions. Like, for example, if I say ü, I have said something that is marked for singular. When I say war, that is not the case, because in classical Chinese, war can refer to many people. Do you have it? Can be we. When I say Xian Jun, deceased ruler, that is almost always the recently deceased, my father, who is just dead. Xian Jun, former ruler, is singular. If you want to read classical Chinese fluently, you expect that. And then you have two or three exceptions, but they are oddities. You know, they are deviations from a very general pattern. Xian Jun is your former ruler who is just dead. Whereas, Zinyu is always plural. Whereas Xian Wang is always plural, but rarely also can be singular, you see? But, you know, of 500 Xian Wang occurrences, perhaps two are singular. Xian Wang are the former kings, collective, a set. So then you have Xian Sheng, right? Collective. Never an individual. You have it? Xian Sheng. A former sage can never be called a Xian Sheng. That's just. And you have Zhu Hou, which you probably think is always plural, the feudal lords, right? But I tell you that I have found about 20 examples where Zhu Hou actually is singular. So, for example, you can say about somebody Zhu Hou, yeah, he is a Zhu Hou, and so on. So Zhu Hou is marked for the plural, and this is funny, it's marked for the plural and can function as a singular.
modern Chinese Google can only use the
Yes, sir, 有一个诸侯. That's very interesting, yes. In modern Chinese, that is. So, yes.
Mm-hmm. How do you know that something is a collective? How does it manifest itself as a collective? As opposed to, say, plural tantrum?
Yes, innumerability. So, 诸侯, you see, like, for example, 诸臣, the various ministers, right? They are always, in principle, a son, down to, you know, they are a set of 10 people or something. They are innumerable. Whereas in the plural, you see, that is not involved. So you could say, to me, collective is a subclass of the plural in which you have a kind of well-defined set, imagined, innumerable.
No, that's clear what a collective is, but in Chinese, in the morphosyntax of Chinese, is there a difference between...
It does not say, you see, it's only what I'm saying is that we have expressions that look similar, but which differ distinctly with respect to this behavior of singular, plural, and collective. And zhuhou is distinctly collective. It is never open-ended, you see. Whereas you have of course other plurals that are open-ended.
So how come the former kings are plural tantrum and the former sages are collective?
Exactly. You see, that is the scandal. That is the scandalon. And as Jesus Christ says, if you do not first recognize the scandalon, the scandal of what I'm saying, you will never grow the wiser by understanding it. You see, you have to first say, yes, you know, why? What is going on here? Well, I can't tell you. I can only diagnose the fact that this is how they read it, right? So it's very strange that you have Xian Jun singular and Xian Wang plural. It's very strange, and yet it is the fact. You see, and that is, in fact, the kind of scandal which I like to put forward, you know, because it shows that you have there idiomatic restrictions that are not cognitively motivated by the concepts involved. You see what I mean? Mm-hmm. Then, so a cognitive linguist would not be able to tell you why Xian Jun and Xian Wan should function differently.
But they do function differently.
Indeed. Yeah.
So with the case of the binomes, do you find those pattern more with the pluralia tantum or the plural?
Of course.
Like, do you have any
very dynamics? Many of them are pluralia, I would say, 多种东西, you see? It's always 多种, you see? Of various kinds. They're not just plurals. That's why all this is, in fact, quite a subtle issue.
Do you have any diagnostics like we use for the negative particles, verbs, nouns, like fei and bu? Do you have any diagnostics for pluralia tantrum versus?
That's why I actually sheepishly call them a semantic feature, you know? I do not have a syntactic. Criteria.
So there's no more syntactic.
There's no. I'm very sorry. No.
Okay.
That's. I call these semantic features here. I say that I assign them sheepishly because they don't even form a decent hierarchy. You know, they are in fact ad hoc. You see. So I'm not. You know, I have not systematized that part of the grammar. Okay. Right. So we have, for example, Junzi. And you have in the Zhuozhuan many occasions where Junzi will comment, right? And you have important articles by distinguished colleagues who ask the question, to whom, which Junzi, right? To whom does this refer? And you can only ask that question when you don't know the grammar of Junzi, because that word never refers to Zhang San or Li Si. So, Junzi is generic, except when, as in the Book of Songs, it refers to your lover and your coming husband and so on. It's a completely different meaning. The meaning gentleman or person of superior character, right, is a meaning under which Junzi is never concretely referential. You can never ask who is being referred to. Yes.
I seem to recall there are a couple passages in the Analects where it says the Junza does such and such, and the translators interpret that as referring to Confucius and those.
Yes, I would just add the word miss.
Oh, yeah, so they're wrong.
Yes. No.
Good, okay.
Which, by the way, you know, you delight me by this observation, you know, if really somebody does that, you know. It is a very nice illustration that for our purposes, if you don't sort out the referential styles of the nouns, you are not going to do very subtle philosophy, if you see what I mean. So, Junzi is very clearly, as by the way, James Legge, the great translator, translates it. It is a gentleman would say, right? So, the predicate after Junzi, after the verb Junzi, is never tensed. Do you have it? It is never tensed. The predicate is, in fact, an untensed generalizing description. So, can you, since you ask kindly about this, let us take Shengren. There are those, I'm sure you can find in the literature, who translate Shengren as referring to Confucius, you see? But then I think you should add the word, the morpheme miss. Because Shengren can never refer to Confucius until the late 3rd century BC. And even then, these are very occasional cases, until the 3rd century AD, when Shengren suddenly comes to refer to Confucius regularly. So that you have the same word, sage person, right, which is like Junzi, the gentleman, non-referential, down to basically the 3rd century. But you have some exceptions before, certainly not before the early 4th century. Yes?
So are these semantic features the second tier of the taxonomy?
No, they are, in fact, footnote annotations, you see, that I sheepishly you know, add, because I need them for an adequate teaching of the use of these words. But you see, as I said, you know, I'm not very proud of this. This is an ad hoc description.
But then you could say these are at the very bottom of the taxonomy. These are in, you know, each individual noun will have this feature,
yes,
specified. So
yes,
they're not.
So, for example, if you take a word like a horse, I have nothing to say about it. But if you have a word like Junzi and Shengren, it becomes philosophically very important, right? And so what we want to do is, we want to be able to, in our language of analysis, right? In our language of analysis, we want to be able to mark clearly those cases where something is plurale tantum, singulare tantum, or mainly plural, mainly singular, and so on.
I suppose I don't quite follow the argument for plurale tantum at all, because as I understand, classical and modern Chinese doesn't necessarily have certain reflexes that indicate plurality.
Yeah, we get to that now. Let's do that, yeah. So, we have the nominals, and we say that the nominals N in the large version, the capital N, right? They are constituents of any kind, like E, righteousness, Yao, Emperor Yao, Gu Dai, ancient times, or Gu Dai Shengren, or indeed the ten Yaos, and so on. You have it? All these are N. You have it? We don't distinguish any from any other. Then we have the monosyllabic ones that are N, then person, or N, M, Shui, and so on. We have that. We've been over this, no problem. But we now revert to Yo, Ren, and we realize that this cannot mean the man is there. Interesting. in classical Chinese, yoren, you see, would be a person. So you have, this is interesting for you, you have this thing that is clear indefiniteness, it's not morphologically explicit, but if you know classical Chinese, then yoren will not be expected to mean there is or was this person. No. So it's interesting that, in fact, whereas indefiniteness is unmarkable in classical Chinese as far as I can see, it is very often obligatorily understood, as in this case. That is to say, you understand this only if you have a cognitive category, indefinite, which you apply here. Only then do you read Chinese fluently. Yeah.
Did classical Chinese have reduplication?
Reduplication, yes.
So ren-ren-tian-tian.
Yes, but not with this function.
Okay.
There is, by the way, if you are interested, there is a beautiful orgy of a dictionary of reduplication in classical Chinese. If you're interested, I can distribute the PDF of it. It's very, very nice. So reduplication is a fascinating phenomenon, but it does not aid us here. So?
Talking about indefiniteness, is the word for a indefiniteness?
Some, yes. You could say, but it's not a marker of indefiniteness. And you will be pleased to know that if we get as far as we, I hope in our last class we will, or next, last but one class, we will talk a lot about Huo. So, then we have the NC countable, which is counted, right? So one thing is to be countable, another thing is to be counted. Why do I have this? I can tell you why. It is because we would like, in our encyclopedic understanding of classical Chinese, to know what actually gets counted. You know, because it turns out, if you do this as I have done, that very few things get counted. And one would like to know which, you see? And it's all very interesting. Huh? It gets close to, if you like, it gets close to an ethnography of counting. You get what I mean? An ethnography of what tends to get counted in the literature that we possess. And that's actually quite limited. Very few things actually are in practice are currently often counted. So then we have among the mass nouns, there is water, right? And there is never the water, right? There is water. Then you have the NM post counted, so the new Chu. And there you have Chu, domestic animal, right? So he has five domestic animals, it's impossible to say in Chinese. You see? Because Chu is counted by the kind, it's NM, Liu Chu, the six domestic animals, and so on. So when you count, what you count is not a Chu, but San Niu Si Ma Wu Gou. So the horses, the dogs, and the buffalo. Right? These are counted. And they are never counted by the kind. Then you have an NM add N. Can you see? A Jinren. Right? And this raises interesting questions. Why? Because Jin indicates the material of which the ren is made. And a jinren actually, in the Mojing, in the logic book of the Mozi, it would say, jinren fei ren ye. A jinren is not a man, right? Because, of course, a man made of wood is a statue and not a man. You get it? So it's all very interesting. Can you see what I mean? By adding an NM add N to a noun like ren, you are actually changing the meaning of the main noun, right? Because suddenly, ren is not actually a living, a human being, but a statue of one.
Would you not call it an exocentric compound? No, that's not how we use that.
Not how
it needs to be a third term for compound.
Yes, yeah. But you would be tempted to think along these lines, you know, one is sort of casting about and thinking of such possibilities, yes. But it's fun, you know, for the logician it is fun, you see, because you modify ren, and suddenly in this modification, actually the meaning of ren gets changed. Therefore, this nm ad n is very different from, shall we say, hanren, right? Because a hanren, a man of Han origin or from the Han region, would of course be a person, right? And be modified by a noun, but not by an nm, right? So it's all very interesting. If you have a set of nm and n, they all have this in common, that they change the meaning of the noun which they modify. Mu ji, for example, is a cock made of wood, which means it isn't a cock, but a statue of one, and so on. Do we have it? So, yes, it's. What we are saying, of course, is that the operation here of the language is one where you cognitively apply logic naturally and do not proceed in a mechanical way, right? You do not maintain the meaning of the modified noun. I think. Right. So then we have the NM ad V. These are wonderful. You have water walk, right? Shui xing. That's very nice. It is by way of water, by means of water, on the medium of water, it sings. To sing. And we then have an NM ad V. And you can see that shui liu right, the Dao shui liu er bu zhi. The way, shui liu, it flows along like water, naturally downwards, and so on. Can you follow the importance of this? The nature of the adverbial modification is not the same. So, what we have noted about adverbial and ad, you know, n and n and so on, the multiplicity of meanings of the ad applies also here. Adverbial, you know, can involve many different concrete semantic contents. They have this in common, that an nm modifies and precedes a v. Can you see that? So there's nothing mechanical there. And of course that is so important to stress because it reduces the mechanizability of the interpretation. You see? There is nothing mechanical about ad. You have to think in the style of Ronald Langacker, you know, cognitive linguistics. You know, you find the address. You get the general logical structure, but the exact address, the semantic address, you have to find yourself by informal means. Yes, you have something. Good. So now, then the next thing is our abstract nouns. So we have E, right? There is rectitude. We have these counted. And you have, for example, also U, E, by the way. But you can have that. E can be counted. Rectitudes. That is to say, conceptions of rectitude. And can you, if you still have the energy, try to think. When you say U, E, the meaning of E has changed. It's very interesting. Because when you just say E, it is what is correct. You see? But when you say U, E, you see, they are competing, they're different. Then suddenly, what is considered as correct is the meaning of E. You get it? I say it again, slowly. You have E, rectitude, justice. Then when you say six justices, the meaning of the word justice has changed. You see? Because then it's no longer justice, but conceptions of justice. And that is...
How is that different from just justice being conceived?
Because when you say E, it's a moral term of absolute validity, right? It is what you should do, shut up. You know, that is E, what is right. And when you have U, E, you see, then it's what somebody might consider or what somebody considers as E. Well, that's not something where you say, shut up, you know, this is he considers, well, I consider, you know, somebody might think differently. It's a subjective, you know, it is a conception of justice, but not justice itself. So, from a logical point of view, absolutely two different meanings of E brought about by the number modification. Do we have it?
So
it's fun.
So would you also then say that like sin and then seven sins were also changed in similar ways by numbers?
No, because they're the same kind of sins. Of course, there are a slight difference because it is specification, but in this case, seven sins are seven, are not seven conceptions of sin. If that was the meaning of seven sins, then you would be right. By the way, this is brilliant, you know. A beautiful example to bring this out exactly, right? The seven sins are, in fact, sins in the same of the sin. Subcategories. And so, very fine, no problem. You can mechanize that in your formal grammar, you know, your computerized processing. But when it comes to liu yi, you see, or si yi, then you suddenly have a different thing because the meaning is no longer sub-kinds, yeah, of generally agreed, but indeed different conceptions. And by the way, I think if you want to do Chinese philosophy or intellectual history, you better make these kinds of distinctions. Because if you really regard Liu Yi as two sub-kinds of justice that all belong under justice, then they wouldn't be competing and in that context where this phrase occurs with Liu Yi, you see, that is not the case. You see, they are competing.
Is this comparable to like the word earth? Like we live on earth and we have only one earth?
Yeah.
Is it comparable to that? Yeah.
No, well, we have one earth, that is very interesting. It's also a more abstract use of earth, yes. It's very subtle. But let's...
I think it seems like languages do stuff like this all the time.
And all the more reason to try to understand what they all
do.
I'm not saying this is out of this world, I'm just saying quietly, you see.
Maybe it's just my own lack of knowledge, does the Liu Yi have specific idiomatic or cultural connotations?
Well, I think, for example, your case of the seven sins, you know, was perfect. You know, it's like a dream, so beautiful. It makes clear this difference, you know. You see that for some reason, you know, we don't take the seven sins as seven conceptions of sin. And for some reason, I don't know why, you know, and it's not particularly because they're very Chinese or something, you know, but for some reason, when they count e-justices, you see, it is competing notions of justice.
It's the accident of cultural history.
Yeah, if
yeah.
you like. Well, accident, yes. Mm. Yeah.
Yeah,
contingencies of intellectual discourse. Yeah. So let's go. We have N ab ad N, you see. Yo li ren, yo yi ren zhe. That's very interesting. So what is this? You know, li ren. Is what goes together, right? Here, it must. Grammatically, it could also not, but in this context, it must go together. So, you have a person characterized by ritual propriety, and a person characterized by justice. So it is an N ab ad N. You get it? It's an abstract noun which modifies a noun. I hope you can see this is really quite fun. I was quite pleased when I discovered this. You see, because you might think that you could derive Li Ren from Li Bi ritually correct, right? And that is not verbal, it is nominal. Li, yeah, as we will see, is in fact an N ab pred, predicative N ab. And not a verb. Okay, so we have also wonderfully N ab ad V. And by the way, you can surely find many translators who fail to recognize this and translate, you know, his heart was pleased. But his heart was not. He was pleased in his heart. It's as sure as hell how all this has to be taken. You see? And it doesn't help to read translations. You just have to learn the language. Preferably from the aboriginals, if you see what I mean. You see, if, you know, you have to study with the Chinese and see how they do it, and they don't, you know, this is adverbial senior, you know, is to be pleased in one's heart. So when there is no subject, you still create a subject. You then say, ta senior. And that pronoun is normally zero. Do we have it? The you know, senior. So the abstract nouns, I think, show a very nice variety, and you can see, if you now go into Thesaurus Linguae Sericae, for each of these categories, you can see how many hundreds of them there are, and you can see, fortunately, examples that are translated where this occurs in the text. Right, and this is the joy of that TLS business, that you can find translated examples where these forms occur. So, for example, if you want to look up N, M, and N, like Jinren, then you find there are no more than 40 or something such NM. Whereas some of these other categories are much larger. Do we have that? By the way, I think it will interest you when you look at 11131, it says Ren Ben Yo Liu Qing. Can you see the Ben? Beautiful. N at V. You have it? Are you with me? Ben is basically, right? But of course, it's no use saying basically it is an N that is adverbial. Do we have it? Very nice one. And then, yo liu qing. I think it's very important for you to realize that these are not emotions, but instincts for emotions. So, liu qing are the six capacities for emotions. Episodic emotions in Chinese are very rarely, they are not very rarely called a qing. The qing are essence, essential instincts. interesting, I think. And and thus they are different from xin, nature. What is the difference between xin and qin? What do you think? Right? Let me just explain to you. Xin is what you have by birth, as such, by virtue of being born, you are like that. That is xin. And qin is what you have by virtue of interacting with other things. So there is no such thing as, you know, an autistic qin, in the sense of completely autistic, completely self preoccupied. It is always a reaction to something. Right? Qing is a reaction to. It is affective, appetitive, or rejecting, but it is always of that sort. Whereas xin is ren xin sha. How does that translate into Chinese, into English? Ren xin sha. Ah, you see? I'm so pleased you said that.
Human nature.
You see? Because Ren Xing Shan. Can you think again? Is that really talking about Ren De Xing? No. The subject is Ren.
The human is kind in nature.
Of course, that's not English, but it's correct. Yes, you see? And you have it exactly correct, right? Man by nature is good. And once you think about it now, your Lao Shi will have told you the same thing.
Yeah, I think I'm more appropriate because it would be, as for humans, the nature is good.
Well, of course, the nature, Well, I think, personally, that is so close that we cannot argue very well. But the point is, that this xin is very adverbial in many ways. Xin shan is, you know, is by nature, natural. It's like ben shan, you know, and so on. You know, you have these things. It's not the ben that is shan, you know. So you have ben shan, xin shan, you working the same way. So
my intuition is that ren is a topic. It's extracted from ren ji xin, ren xin shan.
Yeah, I mean, I have to say, I don't think that we have two competing interpretations here. You can take it that way. I think that the essential insight is that the topic is Ren, and then about that topic, it is said that that person is by nature good, that his nature should be good is not very interesting, you see, because he is supposed to be good. Now we are into philosophy, you see? Because his nature being good is no good, you see, if he is a white dun. If he's a, you see what I mean? You know, so, his nature can be good, but actually, you know, what he does with it is terrible and so on. No, you see, the philosophy of it, if you ask me, this is, of course, from the science of Jing, Qing, Ben, Shang. So, what it says is that man, it is he who is good and by nature. And not just that some nature that he originally has, but then perverts, and so on. But that's a philosophical issue. And I think it illustrates beautifully how the things we are here discussing are absolutely necessary for any philology of Chinese that has any subtlety. You would need to discuss this. We can't solve all problems. Let's go on here. Post abstract nouns are very interesting. You have the Wang Dao. And how would you translate that, Wang Dao? Can you do it? What would you say, Wang Dao?
The way of the king.
See, very interesting. So you now say the way of the king. And you can see what we're doing is a kind of linguistic sensitivity training. You know. I think, after all the discussions we've had, probably you are already tired and so on, but you now realize, oh my God, you know, there are deep problems, right? It could, of course, be the way of King Asan or Asu, right? But that's very rarely how Wang Dao is used in Chinese, right? Very rarely. It could be used like that. What it will mean is something different. What is that? The king of the way of a wandra, the
yeah.
true king, right? Then you have it. Wandra zhi dao, zhi wang dao. That would be how I think Zhao Qi, who died in 201 AD, would have, I think, explained it if he wanted to, in his commentary on Meng Wang Dao. Is wandra zhi dao. So it is the way of a wandra, a true king, a king worth his salt. That is a wandra.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And so this is quite interesting, I think. It is a king who is worth his salt, of whom a way is typical. Right? So it's very abstract.
It's like Bushido for kings.
Yes. By the way, can I just ask you, wandra, does that refer to a concrete king or not? Does that can one
so.
Ask Asan or Asu?
No, I don't think so.
Precisely. See,
right.
We have learned some Chinese here now. You see, the wandra is like junzi.
Mm-hmm.
You get it? And lots of people get this wrong in their translations. You know. Ah, yes. But that's also one of those issues which we must discuss in terms of Jingdian Shiwen glosses. Does it go wandra or does it go wandra? The cases I have found are almost, in fact, all wandra, not one. So it's interesting. You can. This is an empirical question. We can. That is your syntax wrong. I will give you the example. Why. See, blah blah blah, 而不忘者的这个上下文里, there is no 忘者. There is no 忘者, you know. It is 而不忘者. You know? So you really, that's beautiful. So you have actually 忘者 occurring together. Right? But they're not in construction. Because what is in construction is blah blah blah, but not become a king. That is, has the jur.
Okay.
The scope of the jur is not the one. And I know the phrase that you're thinking is in Menses. And there it is, of course, one jur. But that's irrelevant to our issue. Because we are talking about the one jur, where the scope of jur, that which, the nominalizer, is only one. You have it? So that was a beautiful, you know, a very nice case to bring out, you know, the discipline that we are bringing to bear, the logic.
So if these two characters appear as an NP, it's usually read as one.
Yes. But it's very interesting. When they occur together, they don't necessarily constitute a constituent. That's what we have just seen. Because the constituent that you actually referred to was the constituent blah 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 r one, which was modified by Zhe. So that was the constituent, and there was no constituent one Zhe there at all.
But I think if there's enough context provided, you can just delete all the other things and say one. I don't think it's.
You could. I would need to see the context. You could. I can see contexts where this would be possible. You're right. But that's different. The ordinary, what we're saying, the common and garden wandra is in the second tone, right? And then you can have, conceivably, circumstances where you would say, wandra, somebody who becomes a king. Yes, I could see that. Even without other stuff before. I could see your point. It's not grammatically excluded. It's fun. And you can see here that in French, this raises interesting questions. My very dear friend Léon Van der Meer, who's 91 and currently giving his Lao Zongyi lectures in Hong Kong, still going strong, And he translates one Dao as la voix royale. You see, which is very interesting because by royal he means exactly one jode. You see, so in French, the royal here, you see, does not mean that the way is king-like, not at all. You see, but that the king is that of a the way is la voix royale is that of a true king. That's what the French means. So you can see it's quite interesting. Yes.
So I was wondering if you could go back to the last slide, because I had a question regarding the semantic scope. So it seems in this case, the system that you're saying has a certain scope over either Wang or Dao, and in the case of 11133 here with Xinhua, Xinyue, where would this semantic scope necessarily be? Would it be on Yue over having scope over Xin, or Xin having scope over Yue?
Well, what we are saying is that we expect to see Xinyue in a context where the context specifies a subject who of whom it is said that in his heart he is pleased. Yes.
So in the case of the one where you have postpose nouns having semantic scope over the preceding binomial, what's sort of the running understanding of semantic scope, or at least word formation in classical Chinese?
Well, there are those
it seems
like
that you sort of have to and fro with these two examples.
Yeah, I think it's useful here to remember what I said. The concept of a word is not well defined for classical Chinese. So, word formation is not an issue very intelligently discussable. Why? Because all formation of words, by and large, is syntactic. So whatever you will declare to be a word is going to be formed by principles that are themselves syntactic. Under these circumstances, it makes not very stringent sense to distinguish between a syntactic idiom, type idiom, and a word, right? That's why. Let's go on here. So we have this, we have the Wang Dao. We also have the Xiu Shen. How do you translate the Xiu Shen? What would you say?
To cultivate good personality?
Yes. And that's now very interesting. You cultivate, and now comes the Shen, right? What we are saying about the Shen is it's a very strange animal. It is not cultivate personality because you don't cultivate somebody else's, you see? Xiu Shen is cultivate 自己的身. So what we have is we have a Shen that has an understood preceding modifier, right? That is lexically predictable. So if you know if you have a good dictionary, it will tell you that Shen is 自己的身. And now you can say, but Christoph, we don't have good dictionaries, indeed. But we will never have one if we don't tell people what it should be like. And it should specify for Shen that it is your person. And it should specify, for example, for Wang, that it is our king, normally, right? So Wang is very largely His Majesty, our king. And that is not in the dictionaries. Well, so much the worse for the dictionaries. A good dictionary would have this, you know. As, by the way, you have in other cases the need to put qi, his, but not in the case of Wang, you see. You very rarely say Wu Wang, our king, Wu Wang. Wang. Ah, well, very interesting. Now you say body, and there, of course, I completely disagree. Indeed, it is a pregnant person, the graph. But Shen is an abstract noun, personality.
But I think from a semantic point of view, it's not quite possible to cultivate someone else's personality.
Well, you could, you could cultivate, you could buy through education in all sorts of ways. you could, you see, but then it would not be shen, you know, it would not be shen. So what I'm saying is you learn classical Chinese, one of the things you learn about classical Chinese is you see the word shen, you know, and it is in fact self-referential.
So then is the combination of these two things here motivated on a semantic type of agreement, or?
It's a large set of n post minus n. There are lots and lots, and you can look them up, there are hundreds, right? Things that are naturally understood as being one's own, you know, or somebody's. That's very common.
But following his comment about how you can't necessarily cultivate another's personality,
yeah.
Is the fact that Shen follows Xiao in this case motivated by the semantic agreement that Shen has some sort of lexical property that encodes you one's own body?
No. You know, in fact, you can, for example, other people's person, you see,
mm-hmm.
would also be Shen.
So
but in Xiu Shen, you see, then you would have Qi Shen, his person. That's the whole point. You know, the default of the Shen is, you know, one's own in the object position. Mm-hmm. But it is relevant here to point out to you that you could say in classical Chinese, Shen Wang, himself, he died, you see? But that is not his person. That is grammaticalized almost, I think it's almost pronominal, Shen, where it is a reflexive pronoun oneself. That's what you also have. We have a very good conversation going here. I think lots of interesting things are coming up. Let's go and see how it goes. You have shang bu neng gu. Shang, those above, bu neng, be incapable, and then gu. And you can see, here is a case for you to study what scope is all about. Scope of gu is the whole of shang bu neng. You see? It is because shang bu neng, those above are incompetent. Well, I think we have in this world this problem. Shang are not necessarily very known when they lead their wars and so on. And so, Shang Bu Neng Gu says the head of this construction is Gu, right? And the content of this Gu is specified by Shang Bu Neng. And so you have a wonderful case of a sentence with a subject, Shang, and a predicate, Bu Neng, modifying the head who reason. So that's a very interesting case, and I swear to you there are not many enab post minus s. You know, this is, you can see, this is an odd ball. It's an interesting case. But we have, if I can now just remind you, we have Zhe, which is an N pro post minus V or S all the time. So we have the Zhe when it means if is in fact of that sort. Do you have it? When Zhe hu Zhe yede Zhe, this nominalizer, means if, then the correct reading of it is N pro post minus S in the case of, and it's very much like this. Can somebody see that, the point of that? For example, Ma Bu Jin De, if the horse doesn't, it will not proceed, then we will do such and such. You have quite a lot of those, right? They are subordinating post-sentential. I can speak of them with some confidence because in 1981 I have a whole chapter in my book on aspects of classical Chinese grammar on zhe as a conditional marker. So it's and what I'm saying by it's a conditional marker is, of course, that it cometh after a sentence, right? And it nominalizes that sentence and makes it into an iffy topic. That's what it is. Yeah, that is this kind of subordinate inter.
Do you think it's translated as the fact that?
Yeah, as for the, you know, in case of the fact that, you see, in case of an occurrence like that.
No, this is in case of.
Of him not doing such and such, you see?
I don't think it's a condition of sentence or anything like that. It's just. I think in this sentence too means circumstance.
Yeah, it's a. It's
circumstance where something.
Yeah, you know, we have to be careful here. I am not claiming that je means if. I only say it becomes very clearly translatable by if, you see. And what becomes so translatable is a topicalized sentence. That's it. And yours is a case of that. It's a topicalized sentence. It's very interesting. And it's quite common. If you are interested, we can take it up next week, you know. But let's go. I hope to do a little more of our program here today. So here we go. Predicative and transitive abstract nouns. So you have, for example, liye. Can you now see? Liye is very common. It cannot have a subject, therefore it's a straight zero, right? And it is an abstract noun and it is predicative. Hmm? And it means this is in accordance with ritual. And it's interesting that here you could say, we would say, you know, if I didn't know lots of Chinese, you know, that why not take the sentence that comes before as the subject? And never find any living Chinese scholar who thinks that way, and I can't, you know, it's not, yeah, it's not the case. They, you know, the, of course, punctuation is always before the media. So, right, we have that. Then we have an abti. You have the zheng, right? Which is transitive. Why? Because it has is the administration of the state. And here we can see that the valency of the verb to administrate carries over to the noun administration. And that's what works here.
So how would this take an argument?
Well, the zheng has the argument guo, because it is the administration of the object guo. The logic is simply that that we have here a noun zheng, which is never used as xing zheng, as a verb, and it still has this valency of the object.
So my question would be for understanding sort of more of the process of classical, because I haven't had a classical yet, so I'm sorry if I'm asking too many questions, but if you have words in modern Mandarin like zheng ming, that can be translated as to certify or to testify, but also as certification or testimony.
You know, zheng ming would be a rectification, rectifying name.
But it would be like rectify and also rectification.
But it's not this zheng.
I know it's not this zheng, but what I'm saying is that you have words in modern Mandarin that have a similar process that they can be
understood as
either a transitive verb or an intransitive verb or a noun, right? They're sort of.
But the scandalon here is that our zheng is never a verb and still it is here transitive. This is quite, you know, a very interesting phenomenon. That you can, you know, it's like the murder of somebody, right? We call that also transitive. It's a transitive noun, murder. Murder of, right? And in exactly the same way, you here have something, except that murder has to murder, right? Which makes it clear. And we have no zheng as a verb attested in the literature, not that I know of.
Okay.
Zheng is never to administrate. It is only administration, government. But quite interesting in that way. So then we have the pronouns, and I think it's worth your attention. We have wo, which means I, wujia, my, and pro an en, and then you have en pro an en one, post et two, ren, zhi, ben. Zhi is interesting, right? It is an en and post and two. You get it? So we have explained away the need to call zhi a kind of unique particle. We have explained it in terms of what we always use to ascribe a structure to Chinese expressions. So we have zhi, ren, zhi ben, the basis of humanity, right? Then zhi ben goes together, and the whole thing is modified by ren. So this is very nice. And it will please you, I think, if I tell you that zhi in very old texts very often means this, like zhi ren, this person. And that's exactly how it functions here. So it's very beautiful. But this is not the time where we will go into detail about this kind of pronoun. So we have that. Then we have en pro ad en ab, si wen. Very interesting. That is quite rare. You know, you have surprisingly few zi dao this way and so on. You know, this is, but we have si wen, this culture, this elegance in Lun Yu, and it's quite rare. And then you have en pro ad vi, he gan si, right? He. By what means? Gansu. It is without great pleasure that I call her here an end pro. You know, but what can I do? Life is. It's really a tricky one. That's a very tricky one. This one. Why? Then we have for the pronouns wa. The first person pronouns, the following set. We have wo, I for my part, assertive, contrastive, subject position, right? Then you have wu, always non-contrastive and default. Never I for my part versus you, you see? It's a kind of quiet I. I don't know. I don't know. Wu bu zhi. You see? Whereas wa bu zhi would be more assertive. I don't know, perhaps somebody else does. Then yu, totally different again. Yu is always singular, never plural. Whereas wa and wu are often plural. Yu is always very personal and it's experiential. So yu is very common in poetry, so you find lots of it in Li Zhao, Chu Ci, in ancient poetry that is personal. Then you have a preference for yu, especially, by the way, when Sima Jian, the historian, writes his Tai Shi Gong Yue, you know, his comments by the grand historian at the end of each chapter. Then he would say, I've been up that mountain, the temple is still there. You see, he says all the time. Huh? That's very interesting. So I think you can check dozens of in the personal remarks at the end of his biographies and his treatises.
If I were to say, I have been to Paris, I've experienced Paris, I would have to use that, or it's not.
No, there. Well, if you say my wife hasn't, you know, what? You see, then you would say, I have been, but she hasn't, you see, that's the problem. Then it would be what? But for example, if I've always been addicted to Lafroig. I've always been addicted to a Lafroig whiskey would be. This, by the way, already applies to such texts as the Shujing of the very early texts already have this yu clearly different from wa and wu. But of course there are, you know, pesky examples that don't work perfectly. And then there is zhen, which was always already in Shujing authoritative. You know, I, and you better listen to me. This kind of pushing your weight around, zhen, right? But it came to become, of course, the imperial pronoun, restricted to the emperor. It has to be said that this zhen is curiously common, actually, also in the Chuzi, and somehow I don't know. I have no good explanation why suddenly Chuzi uses it in not in this throwing the weight around. Yeah, maybe it's dialect, but our problem, sir, is we would wish that Chuzi was full of southern Chinese dialect words, you know, and we find hardly any, and it's all very depressing. It should be full of this, you see, but isn't. You see? So the Chuzi is actually written by and large in recognizable classical Chinese. Mm-hmm. Yeah?
This might be an unanswerable question, but do you know how you came to be a surname?
I don't. Yeah, it's interesting. But of course, Yuanshi and so on, you know, Yuanshi is the great master of Taiwanese historiography, and his name is Yu. By the way, if you're interested, I have just received a completely comprehensive treatise on all personal names recorded in the Zhuozhuan. This is 4,700 or something. And every name is being discussed in the way that you ask for here now. So that's a very interesting book. 700 pages. Beautiful treatise on onomastics of personal names in China. I think it's a unique work. But of course it wouldn't have all. By the way, if you are interested, we also have, of course, the Zhongguo by Xin Cidian, a huge dictionary where all these would be explained, but it's not so authoritative. So one can look this up, you know. You certainly can, but not in Han Yudan Cidian. You need to go to these specialized dictionaries which I can give you, and you can look up.
The pronoun die out pretty early in the colloquial language.
A colloquial, we don't know. I wasn't there, you know. We only have.
I mean, from these records of the. Like,
yeah, you have in Shujing, you have Yu, that's.
I mean, after Qin.
Oh, yes, yeah.
Yu is still used.
Oh, yes, in poetry a lot, you know. Yeah.
But in modern dialects, if no dialect is the first person pronoun or something like
that. No, but in modern dialects, you have Allah. You have Allah. No, but it is. You have very strange things in many dialects for war. You have even binomes in Shanghai
yeah.
And Ningbo. You have they say Allah. But I don't pretend that I speak Shanghainese. So can you see now? We have seen a fair amount of the. A variety of uses of nouns, and we will see no more because next week we will do the verbs. After that, we will do the pronouns, After that, we will do a most remarkable phenomenon of Chinese, the palindrome, huiwen, which shows a great deal about syntactic structure and flexibility of words, and also about the way in which Cheng Yu enter a modern Chinese, and then we want to finally, in the last class, we want to do quite intensely some systematic constraints. That is to say, some limitations of what you would have thought any language can do and what classical Chinese can't do, doesn't. So the last lecture will be actually very special in that it will concentrate on the limitations of classical Chinese. For example, to what extent can you have a language that doesn't have a word for all, and so on, that does not have things that you expect. And we will find quite a few phenomena there that are interesting to consider after we have ascertained the wealth of things that do exist in Chinese. So that's the plan. That is, by the way, the sort of syllabus. And I can write it out for you. Thank you very much for your numerous attendance. See you next week.